Good afternoon, participants, and welcome again. Our next session for the day is on retail asset audits by Mr. Pranay Bhattacharya. Pranay Bhattacharya heads the audit of retail assets, rural assets, and corporate center audits in ICICI Bank Limited. He is with ICICI Bank Limited since 2005 in the home loan business. He then moved into internal audit in 2008. Prior to that, he was with UTI Technology Services Limited for around 10 years. Academically, Pranay is a graduate in physics from IIT Kharagpur. Welcome, Pranay.
Thank you, Parsi. Thank you so much. Good afternoon, guys. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Good afternoon. I'll share the presentation. Do let me know whether it's coming, it's visible.
Yes, it's visible, Pranay.
Thank you.
Can you go here?
Yeah. So this is the subject. I'm jumping to the presentation. Percy, with your permission and with the concurrence and permission of the organizers.
Yes, please. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Once again, good afternoon, guys. This is a subject very close to my heart. I'm into this retail asset business. Business includes audit. The business of retail asset for the last 15 years. So the presentation is to just draw your attention towards the subject. I would love to talk. And while we have a questionnaire session, at the end, I would welcome any question in between if there is any need or you feel you need to, you need me to elaborate a bit more. Broadly, these are the areas which I am going to cover. Initially, the numbers, of course, from a banking's perspective. Then what are retail loans? I'm sure most of us present here would be having a clear idea. This may be a reiteration or a repetition, fair enough, just to bring the context. Then the audit of retail loans. And finally, the question answer session. Guys, again, a request, if you feel, please stop me. We need not wait till the end because the question would have by that time skipped the mind, right? Saturday afternoon. Lunchtime. I will try to make this session not a drab session. Okay, we first start with some figures just to set the context. These are information openly available. Numbers, it's what? It is 258 billion March 2019. That's the proportion of our retail loan business. 26-27% of the overall lending of a bank, of all Indian scheduled commercial banks together. What is scheduled commercial banks? PSBs, private banks, and our foreign banks. So the universe which we are talking about today is this 26%, which is significant. The bulk, as you can see from the Excel, the bulk is on industry. Industry means our corporate loans. This is taken from the Reserve Bank website. And now the most dreaded numbers. If you see the numbers on the right side of your screen, at least on the screen, the net NPA, hovers around 3%. The net NPA hovers around 3%. Now, there is a big catch here. This number is pre-COVID. There was a slight improvement in the NPA bank-wide overall as of March 2020 as compared to last year. And then we have the onslaught of this pandemic. I will talk about forecasts, but what it is going to lead, only 31st March 2021 numbers can tell. I was going through many articles. Reserve Bank of India notes, their publications. But as we speak, nothing concrete has evolved. Only prayer from all of us, I'm sure, is let the pandemic end. The numbers will may, the net numbers may go up from 3 to 4, 3 to 3.5, 3 to 4, 4.5. Let the net, these numbers, the pandemic end first. I always make it a point to demonstrate the source of this information. They are available in public domain, right? Now, this is a slide which all of us probably know. I need not repeat the slide. I want to draw your attention here. What is this others? If you see the RBI numbers, around 24% of the retail loans is under others. I will show that slide. Now, others include here personal loan, commercial business loan, maybe gold loan. I didn't find any specific list under this others. What is a retail loan? Many definitions in many websites, in many banks. I personally perceive retail loans is a loan given to an individual for a specific personal use. It encompasses all his requirements. It is for his or her personal use. And putting in a slightly different wordings, when a bank pays for a person's shopping, this shopping word is very important here. When I say traditional written products, they are there since ages. Previously, it was more unstructured in the rural segment. It is still unstructured in non-rural, in metros, category A, B, C, cities, it is more structured because banks are there. Over the last couple of years, and especially the COVID pandemic, we have seen certain new products coming in. All may not be linked to COVID. But last 3-4 years, we have seen these new age retail products, wallets, digital credit cards, virtual cards, pre-approved loans, and a new dimension of processing loan that is instant. Now, these are game changers. Maybe after 5 years, when this session happens, this new age retail loan will be a part of the traditional one, because the number of hits, the sheer number of transactions in wallets is phenomenal. Why do you need a physical card? Do you really need? You need a number and the CVV. That's it, right? Pre-approved loans. A customer is assessed by his intent and capacity of repayment. This is the thumb rule of lending. Why should I be bothered whether he takes an auto loan or a car loan? These are the thoughts. Why should I be bothered if he takes an auto loan or a home loan or a personal loan? The rates may be different. There may be security, another unsecured loan. But should I be bothered as a bank? I'm not in the business of reposition and reselling of the asset. And instant processing. Gone are those days when our earlier generation had to buy new shoes standing in queues of banks. Those are history. So over a period of time, it is felt this new age retail products will also form a part of the traditional retail loans. The unique point of these products is, especially the wallets, it may not be high ticket loan. It is, they are small, 10,000, 20,000. But the sheer number of transactions is phenomenal. It's phenomenal. Basically, it talks about taking a loan to buy a cup of tea. That's a wallet. Anyway, at the cost of repetition, what is retail credit? When banks pay for your shopping. Again, some drab numbers. This is the broad breakup of scheduled commercial bank loans. As I said, others is not insignificant. 53% is home loan, traditionally the safest bet for any bank, for the Indian psyche. We can default in a personal loan. We can default, I'm talking about a general cycle. We can default in a credit card. But the last thing which one household would like to or compelled to default is the home loan. Traditional product, backbone of every retail banking in India. We have talked about a number 3%. Sorry for the disturbance. No problem. We have talked about a number 3% of net NPA. This report shows a 2% for the retail portfolio. Broadly, it is hovering around 1.8, 2.2. Over the last 2-3 years, rider here. Forecasts about 31st March 2021, I have not come across any authentic forecast. These others, the one which is marked in blue, I would want to delve around 1 minute around on it. It also includes a two-wheeler small ticket loan. I would like to draw your attention here. Do you know which is the largest consumer of petrol, not diesel, which is the largest consumer of petrol in India. Since you know, I would encourage you to please question and unmute yourself and ask questions in between, right? These are the advantage of physical engagements. Yeah.
Pranay, the platform will not allow them to unmute fair themselves.
Enough. Fair yeah. enough.
They okay. can post, they can answer it in the chat session and I can post it to you.
Fair enough. I was not aware of that. My mistake. So the largest consumer of petrol are the two-wheelers. In the state of Odisha alone, One such extreme example, 70% of petrol is consumed by two-wheelers. Overall, for the country, around 62-63% of petrol is consumed by two-wheelers. So you can imagine the sheer count of the two-wheelers and the two-wheelers loans associated with these two-wheelers. Similarly, for the personal loan, these are included here. Auto loan, how much is it? Around 28 billion. This sector, there was a huge boom. There was a naysayers paradise kind of a thing couple of months back. Auto loan bit nahi raha hai, auto loan, autos bit nahi raha hai. But numbers of Maruti and Kia shows a different perspective. Yes, there has been a disruption because of the BS4 and BS6 issues. I personally feel over a period of time, this sector would again come back to previous days. Here, there is a very interesting study. 1 million millennials, but there is an increased thought. Why do you want to have a car? Do we need a car? In typically in a city like Mumbai or Delhi, where Ola, Uber have come up so well structured, accountable, there are avenues for complaint. Do you need a car? This thought itself is very scary for a banker. Anyway, as of now, it is too premature to conclude whether it has this thought has an implication on the banking environment. Similar thoughts were there for the housing sector. Housing, why should I have a house when I can afford a rented house? But Indian psyche, Indian thought, traditional Indian psyche wants us to have a house. Period. It is to be seen whether this psyche builds up, such a psyche builds up as it is there for the auto loan. This is a negative kind of a post. Let us see. Now I'll talk about the retail loan risks. People who are associated with retail business, this you may find it a bit repetitive, but generally these are the areas where a bank is exposed to the risks. 15 years ago, when I joined the bank, the word CIBIL was heard once in a week or once in 10 days. Today, it is the backbone of retail lending. Equifax or Experian were there in the West for a long. However, with the contribution of every bank, we could make CIBIL the backbone in India as well. It's a paradigm shift based on which lendings were done prior 20 years back, 30 years back, vis-a-vis what we do today. You take a CIBIL score, the comfort which a credit manager gets from that number tells it all. Inspection, verification, validation, as we progress, I will delve more on it. Valuation of the asset, house, car, the internal approval mechanism, every retail loan is unique. And the tenor of loans. Typically, home loans are given for 20 years. So these have been the focus areas of our retail asset audit since ages. Now I have a question. 20 years is how many generations? They say today, 5 years is one generation. So when I'm extending a home loan, forget home. When I am extending a loan, the tenure, the period of this loan is for 4 generations. It is a separate matter that numbers demonstrated that typical average life cycle of one loan is around 11 years, 10, 12, 9, around 11 years. So we are extending a loan for 4 generations. Generation is not that, you know, in a family, but generation here means the psyche, the changing psyche of people with time.
Pranay, there's a question. Would you like to answer it?
Now? Right. I would love to.
Why the retail NPAs are increasing? Is it because the banks are not reviewing the repayment capacity, or there are other reasons to it? That's the question.
Right. Thanks. First of all, thanks for the question. As the numbers indicate, as of March, it is hovering around 2%. Typically, it is 2.2, 1.8. It varies there. My answer doesn't defend retail because of my association with retail. If you see the corporate NPAs are far more. Corporate NPAs are far more. Typically, banks have gone down because of their corporate lending, not for retail lending historically. In my personal experience and numbers given by RBI, this certain increase in retail NPA happened in 2008, post-2008. But broadly, they are within a tolerant, level. One of the reason it is because the backbone of most of the banks of the retail portfolio is housing loan, where the defaults are far lesser. Typically, unsecured products like credit card or personal loans, short-term personal loan, small business loans, the delinquency trend of these products in the retail sphere are higher. So what typically a bank would do is to curb those portfolio and introspect, maybe stop certain selling this product in certain profiles of customers, certain geographical locations, and they do the course correction. But I would encourage to go by through the numbers of defaults in retail loans, overall defaults in retail loans in the last 10, 20 years, they have shown spikes, undoubtedly. But broadly, they have behaved very well. Especially when you compare a retail portfolio NPS of one bank of overall vis-a-vis the corporate portfolio, the retail segment seems to be doing far better as we speak. So I am not challenging the question here or the question here. But yes, there would be ups and downs, spikes at times. But broadly, the behavior has been good so far, except 2010-11 when there were problems in certain banks. I hope I have answered the question.
Yes, thank you very much, Pranav. Thanks for your thoughts.
Yeah. Again, your perception, the questionnaire perception of the little NPN and my perception might vary. Fine.
Absolutely.
Right. Yeah. So there are certain risks which are internal to the bank. Security, verifications, title search report, collection activities, NPA management. What is NPA management? There's a very critical parameter which is associated with the term NPA management. That is provision. And I tend to believe that the provisioning aspect of a bank is related to the governance culture. A very big statement. Provisioning is related in a large, indicates, I would say indicate the governance culture of an institution. Whether you are clinical, whether you are, there is a biasness. I don't want to repeat or take names, but strictures from RBI on this subject has been profound in recent last 1 year. It has always been there, but they have come down heavily on us bankers, all the banks. Kam jada to hoi sakta hai, that's separate. On this aspect. So collection efficiency, NPA management, and provisioning are a critical factor which is internal risk to the bank. See, a wrong portfolio, wrong in the sense where credit assessment were not good, what will it lead to? It might lead to the lower stock rate of your bank because your NPA would suddenly shoot up and blah, blah. But is a wrong or a high delinquent product going to bring down your bank? A high delinquent retail product, is it going to bring down your bank? My sense is I have never come across any bank where a high NPA retail product has brought down the bank. But most of the banks have suffered because of the governance and that too around provisioning related to NPA management. So from an audit standpoint, it is good to have our radars up here.
Pranay, there's another question.
Please.
Okay. There's a question coming in from Uttam. Where would microfinance stroke GALG loans fall in the retail loan distribution?
I have specifically avoided buyouts and microfinance and in my numbers so far. There would be definitely a part of the retail. MFI lending, you are talking MFI lending. Yeah, it is a part of the retail. But I'm not too sure whether how they have been classified in the RBI reporting. I have to check. I don't have a ready-made answer, but yes. See, there are two things. One, you are funding the MFI who in turn funds the end user, right? Typically, it should be a part of the retail portfolio.
Okay.
The next risk is EMI not affected, data leakage, one of the biggest threats. Tell me one big entity in the world which is today safe from this data leakage issue. One of the biggest threats. As we progress, I think I have enough time. And then bugs, another catchword. Bugs leading to incorrect NPA tagging or non-tagging. Has it any connotation with the intent? From an audit standpoint, that has to be our radar. How can a bug only affect the would-be NPA by not tagging this an NPA? It can be. Or it may be willful, possible. I'm not saying or concluding, it is possible. So far, these are the traditional areas of audit. Again, I want your attention on these aspects, provisioning, intent of clinical provisioning, linking provisioning with the governance culture of an institution and data leakage and use of the word bug to justify any miss. Be careful. There are two dreaded words in banking. Numbers shows that frauds perpetrated by the employees, that means within enemies, are more. Joint venture is the word I have used, where a fraudster connives with one of our staff, banking staff, to siphon off funds. One interesting experience which I have gathered so far, in 10, 15 years back, when PAN was being projected or promoted by IT government, there were cases where they used to give fictitious PAN number and they used to get processed and all those things. Over a period of time, the fraudsters are very, very meticulous in KYC. This is my problem in KYC, because they know that we do a validation. Every bank is doing validation. So they will be caught in the first attempt itself. well. Bad credit decision, as I said, that it happens. You cannot nullify it. In the traditional way, you cannot. Genuine reasons, I think I have to rush up a bit. Genuine reasons. And the black swan events. What is a black swan? I would strongly encourage each one of you, I keep on telling this name in wherever, in every forum. There's a book, Black Swan by Nassim Nicholas Taleb. I have read it twice. And I can assure you, most of you, if you start that book, you will end up reading that book twice or thrice. A black swan is characterized by three things. Absolutely unpredictable. Two, catastrophic. Three, very easy to explain after it has happened. Oh, to malum hi tha mujhe. COVID-19 is a black swan event. Nobody foresaw. No, even today, we do not know the consequence. The book is by Nassim Nicholas Taleb. It's a must-read book. Please read it. It's an eye-opener. These events change the landscape. All your policies and procedures and everything go for a toss. Because collection people are in the hospital. What will happen to your collection? When a loan goes bad, the loan is in hospital, the collection agent is in hospital. So these are black swan event. They are not very frequent. There's the only solace. And as per Taleb, they have to be factored, but they cannot be predicted. Kisko pata tha 2018 mein COVID-19, did we even know that name? Wuhan, that place. Most of us probably didn't know there is a place called Wuhan in China. Right? So these cannot be factored in our, when we write a policy or a procedure or do whatever. But net, who takes the hit? Banks. Whatever negative happens, from a lender's perspective, our bad luck is, whatever negative event happens, we are affected. We are so deep, in other words, in everyday life, so intimately connected, that any negativity hits us. And so much events takes place, it is statistically not possible to have all events positive at the same point in time. Ho sakta hai kya? So anyway, coming back to these frauds and delinquency.
Pranay, there's a question.
Sure.
Pertaining to rural assets. Are there any numbers on agricultural loans and their levels of NPAs?
I have not specifically taken rural, but I have the number in my slide. Agriculture allied activities, 120 billion lending as of September 2019, 1 year back. So its composition is 13%. In the first slide or some of the slides previously, I have the number here. Agriculture and allied activity, that does not include food credit. It is the loan given on agriculture and allied purpose to individuals or entities. Food credit is a different concept. Food credit is what government gives to FCI. It doesn't include, it's a separate matter altogether. So around 13% is the proportion as of September 2010.
Yeah. One more question is pertaining to how much percentage of retail assets under NPA can be moved into the securitization mode or not at all? No.
Can you securitize an NPA? My sense is no. When you buy a portfolio, it has to be you cannot buy an NPA portfolio other than RCL. When there is a business transaction, one bank buying a portfolio to other, it has to be regular.
Right.
Only we can sell portfolio to asset reconstruction companies for NPA portfolios. I'm very happy these questions are coming.
Yeah.
So, when it is 1:30 and people are hungry, still they are alert. Very good.
They are hungry for more information on
this. Oh, thank you. I'm overwhelmed. Thank you so much. I would also delve another 2-3 minutes of this. Okay. I will. The buzzword today, data analytics. Identification of outliers, exceptions. What is a counterintuitive case? I'll give some simple example. Importing cotton from Saudi Arabia, of course, in a trade environment, not in retail. Saudi Arabia doesn't produce cotton. A 23-year-old graduate with a modest background, buying a Lamborghini. He can, but it should be a part of our sample. Chain documents in home loan, contents gift. Boss, kon gift kon karta hai 2 crore ka ghar? Possible, but from an audit standpoint, we should be alert. Import of coconut in Kerala. And the last example is a vegetarian Bengali. Counterintuitive, na? Okay. The next case is analysis of the quick mortality cases, analysis of the delinquent and fraud cases, and try to identify the pattern in the current set of samples which shows similar behavior. Now, these are two words, pattern, behavior. What are the factors demonstrated in the quick mortality, fraud, and delinquent cases vis-a-vis my current book or current set of samples or population, not sample, population, and identify those cases. Deploy resources to verify and validate. I have to do it fast. Validate document submitted. In case a document is supposed to be validated by a third party to internal audit, it may be outside the bank or inside the bank, doesn't matter. We have to audit that entity as well. See, our objective has changed. The expectation or the mandate may be, at least the expectation is early identification of delinquency and fraud. We have to live with it. These are the part of now traditional. Is our job done from an audit standpoint? Guys, there's a new norm. The expectation from the internal auditors have exponentially grown. The accountability has also significantly, exponentially grown, and rightly so. And the third point is digitization. every event has a positive aspect as well. Every bank was, every financial entity across the world were moving towards it. This pandemic accelerated this movement. This is my take. Debatable, but this is my take. It is not that I want the pandemic to come every 10 years, no. But it has accelerated the journey of digital lending across the world. And India is, with a 130 crore population, we are keeping a pace. Banks are keeping a pace. That's a beautiful, positive development. Pre-approved loans. You don't have to wear out your shoe, giving line, you know, our earlier generation, which the way they have to beg for a loan. Instant disbursal at the click of our smartphone. Online validation, verification, NSDL, Aadhaar, everything is available. You, if you have the customer concurrence of validating your KYC to Aadhaar, you can do it. Video KYC, I'm sure all of the banks have started now. And the identification of customers probably will differ, will default, probably. Analytics. Now, crux of the root, which from an audit standpoint we have to attack, is this pre-approved loans. I would like to draw your attention on two facts, which I have not, I want to demonstrate. See, there's a book called When Genius Failed. Roger Lowenstein. There was a company called LTCM, Long Term Capital Management. This fact may be known to many. It will be a repetition for you, but I thought it to highlight this point here. Now, this was one of the massive, huge hedge funds of $126 billion. The company had two Nobel laureate economists in their board. This company ran from 1994 to 1998. The backdrop or the fundamental on which this company ran was on mathematical predictions and postulates. I'm a student of physics. And then the company had to be bailed out by Federal Reserves. And finally, it closed. It was dissolved in 2000. There's a book by Jim Collins, How the Mighty Fall. I would strongly recommend all auditors to read this book. I'm sure most of us have done it. Now, the mathematical prediction predicted that an event where the daily loss of LTCM would be in excess of $35 million is not there. It's 0.n number of zeros, meaning an event where the probability of an event where the loss in one day exceeds $35 million is not there. This was the mathematical prediction. Fact was, in one day, they lost $553 million. Application of wrong formula and the wrong hypothesis. See, every formula in physics has a background, has an assumption. Okay. I'll go back to the black swan. There's another book by Taleb, very popular book, Fooled by Randomness. See, you cannot extrapolate a formula of physics or a chemistry into economics or vice versa. A formula in mathematics have certain assumptions which may or may not work in economics. Why I am highlighting these cases is, see, going forward, auditing this model and accuracy of data aggregation is the key. Because they are all pre-approved. See, 5 years down the line, there won't be any physical files. Let us accept it. You will get a pop-up on your screen whether the KYC is validated or not. Validated. Existence ka sawal hi nahi hai. PAN, iska sawal hi nahi hai. Whether they are validated or not. This information is available, or would be available at the click of your button. So what is the role of an auditor? I have to audit whether this model basis which an offer has been given to a customer, whether that is right. And whether the right data has been aggregated from various sources. So that forms the crux of our focus tomorrow. Otherwise, this entire landscape is going to change. It has changed a lot. And it will be entirely different 5 years down the line. Wo file ka koi chakkar hi nahi rahega. File means what is appearing in the screen, period. So from an audit standpoint, our focus area has to be this. The models, accuracy and data, collection of the correct data
integrity.
Data integrity is the crux.
Yeah.
And the source, authenticity of the source. Today, I'll just digress slightly. If you have a mobile, not a smartphone, where your location is on, if you just have a mobile, it is possible to, the mobile has to be on, it shouldn't be off. A non-smartphone mobile, which is on, it is possible to locate him with the accuracy of less than 10 meters. When you go in a Uber from Malad to BKC, data is there in Uber. Data is there in your credit card. Data is there. Google is tracking you. We may not be cognizant of that. But there are a host of things which is observing you. You means me, all of us. When you make a payment, Paytm or wallets or credit cards. See, this data, increasingly banks would be taking to assess a customer. And hence the accuracy, correctness of this data, the source point has to be once and for all clean. Because if you, for say 1 month, if a bank extends loan to a set of customers which shouldn't have been lent, just imagine the consequence.
So there's a question coming in from Uttam.
Yeah.
It has been observed that the organizations are heavily dependent on third-party verifications and validations of documents or assets. So how can the risks of them being defaulting on genuine reporting be mitigated?
Genuineness of those documents? Is that the question?
It's not very clear though. It says, how can the risks of them being defaulting on genuine reporting be mitigated? It's not
okay.
It's not a very straightforward question.
See, what I could gather is, so putting it simple, that the verification and the physical verification and the validation, how much would an auditor rely on it? This is the way I have understood the question, and I would try to answer it in that way which I have understood. Typically, what we do today is go and see whether the office is there, talk to the customer, see, validate his KYC, appoint some lawyer or our internal experts to go through the legal documents for a home loan. Won't be required anymore. Because we are going to an environment where this would be given. NSDL will validate the PAN. Aadhaar, UIDAI will validate the Aadhaar. You will have a video KYC sitting at your home. So the existence of the customer, do we need to have a physical verification? From March, April 2020 till now, have we done much of physical verification? But banks have lent. Yes, there would be gap. There were gaps in physical verification done by external agencies, done by internal staff as well. No bank can say that all their employees are Yudhishthir. No. But in days to come, maybe months, it is on its way out. This physical business may not stand the test of time. Except for reading home loan documents. Reading home loan documents, chain documents will remain. Chain documents of home loan has to be read through by expert lawyers or internal experts, employees who are lawyers, who knows this subject. Other than that, my personal take is, if there are external agencies or our internal mechanisms of going to a customer, meeting him, asking 10 questions, they will win away. I hope I have answered your question.
Taking this home loan example, there's another question coming in on that subject. Loan on under construction property, should it be classified in secured category? And what is the treatment if the builder fails to construct the property?
Treatment is only, it has to be NPA, simple. I mean, correct. Right. If the builder fails, I don't know whether it would be proper to take names, Amrapali and Unitex of the world. There are so many. Those cases have to be, from a bank standpoint, money is not, we have extended, the money is not coming.
Yeah.
But they are home loans. We have extended maybe 30%, 40% or 80% of their sanction amount we have disbursed as a home loan. So they are home loans.
Yeah, and is this to be categorized in the secured category?
Loan under construction. I'll just find out. You send me that questionnaire. I'll personally respond.
Question. Sure.
It doesn't. All right. I'm not able to recollect that exact provision as of now. I have to check that provision. Right.
Sure.
Under construction.
Then there is another question.
Yeah.
There is another question on stress in retail portfolio has been moving upwards since 2019, and this stress is only likely to further escalate in the current scenario where job losses and closure of small businesses, etc., has happened a lot. So is it logical to have tailor-made checks or parameters rather than following standard parameters across the board?
I will answer this question in the next three slides.
All right, great.
I have around 10 minutes left, right? Around 10 minutes.
You have about 15 minutes.
Right, fantastic. Yeah. The next question?
And the next question says that looks like we are shifting from trust to zero trust, and we have to end up verifying all in a real time and build validations that will dynamically assess and output the results in no time, particularly making the loan disbursements instantly.
I must thank the questioner because he has taken the name of a very, very critical word, which we often forget. See, banking is a business of trust. The underlying of all these presentations is to safeguard the trust, the money which a liability customer, a savings and a current bank account holder. He has trusted you, boss. I cannot miss, betray of his trust. What is the role of a banker? He has trusted his hard-earned money on me. I am supposed to deploy the money through loans and give him the promised interest and earn some money myself. In that process, when I do a validation, it cannot be construed as a mistrust. It is a safeguard. My primordial duty is to protect the interest of the liability customer. That is underlying. That is, unfortunately, in most of the discussions and deliberations, this is often forgotten. But as a bank, that's my primary responsibility. In order to do it, if I need to validate 10 times, I will validate 10 times, boss. So be it. He is trusting me blindly. To keep up to his trust, if I need to perform 10 checks, I will do it. That's my personal take. Because tomorrow, if I fail giving him the interest or he can even not take his principal money out of the bank, it has no justification. I hope I have answered the question. To live up to the trust of my liability customer, if I have to do a validation, better do it. I cannot betray his trust. To acquire a new customer, I can take a prudent methodology of validating and verifying. That doesn't mean I'm not trusting him. Right? I'll move on. So yes, I said I'll ask.
There are lots of questions coming in, but I think we would like to hear from you, and then we will take them.
You had asked this question, 2019, the NPA portfolio. I appreciate your point of view. I fully appreciate. I, as a banker and as an ordinary citizen, have the same thought. But should we always be naysayers? See, doctors say, the impact of COVID is far more psychologically than the harm it has caused, the disease itself has caused. Post-COVID, it is expected that my housing loan of the entire banking industry will boom. This is one of the reports. Outlook India. One sec. Then in the auto also, we are in as we are deep in COVID, or maybe hopefully we are on the boundary of coming out. Auto sector is showing some positive signs. So my request to the questioner is, keep your fingers crossed. Let us not be too much bothered about those negativities. It is there, the negativity is there, but there also is a hope at the end of the tunnel. This is my personal take. Right. The way forward. The data analytics which an audit team does today will automatically, survival has to grow exponentially. Unstructured data needs to be factored in our day-to-day audit life. Gone are the days when we are okay with sampling 30, 60, 90, 100, 200. My sample is my population. Audit cannot wait for 1 year. The risks have to be highlighted to the management fast. As I said, product-centric audit, home loan, auto loan, two-wheeler. Auditing would be the choice of the right customer, whether the bank or the lending institution have taken the right efforts to choose the right customer, whatever may be the product. And dismantle in silos. This is very important. IT audit, functional audit. These are not going to stay anymore. IT is so much intertwined in the banking process today. The audits have to be a comprehensive, covering each and every aspect of each minute detail of a loan life cycle. So my personal understanding, we as internal auditors, we as bankers, even the credit managers who actually evaluate a loan application, we need to reorient our thoughts. 5 years, again, I keep on repeating, 5 years ka baad file nahi rahega. It will be only on screen. Retool in order to factor in the unstructured data, images, CCTV coverages. We need adequate tool. And to use this tool and absorb the change in the technological environment, we of course need to reskill. So this is my thought about, when somebody in 2025 is speaking about retail asset, this slide would be transferred into that traditional, then this becomes a traditional way of audit. Any questions, please? I have, I think, around 4 or 5 minutes left.
Yes, yes, Pranay, there are a couple of more questions.
Please.
So one is on the home loan side.
Yeah.
Especially home loans where it has been there as many agents who can make the loan approved. Even there is some documents which are missing or some errors which are there, still they can, get the loans approved. So how do banks rectify this kind of non-compliances?
There is no non-compliance. Deficiency is not non-compliance. Deficiency in certain document is not non-compliance. It's a credit manager's call. He is employed by an institution to take, to judge that risk. Right, it is not a non, don't, right. What can be a non-compliance? Not taking his KYC can be a non-compliance to RBI. But if a person stands up and says that, boss, I am the credit manager, I am perfectly okay. If there was no verification of his document done, I am taking the call. What is wrong in it? Hope I have answered the query.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, no, please.
Sure.
Yeah.
It's a judgment.
Yeah. It's a judgment. It's a call. Yeah.
Correct. So the next question is from Jeevan. He says that can a model risk be assessed by an internal auditor without an IT background?
I think this question was given sometimes back before my my previous slide. IT, non-IT model, there won't be any silos. We better re-equip ourselves to audit that model as well. See, it forms an integral part of a portfolio auditing. Model throws out those cases which are, you know, there is a pre-approval or a pre-disbursement or a pre-sanction. So you cannot segregate you cannot operate in silos. Right. Yeah, I hope I have right. Answered.
So yeah. Now, yeah. We will take this last question before we wrap up for today. And if there are these further questions, we will forward them or direct them
yes,
to you.
Yes, surely. I'd be happy to respond to those mails.
Sure. So how is disbursement vis-a-vis stage of construction assessed for under construction projects? What are the RBI norms in this regard?
See, the norms. Are developed by individual banks. Typically what happens is when the plinth is constructed, then underground up to the construction up to the plinth level, the banks may decide to disburse X percentage, 5%, 15%, depending on the bank to bank. And then say 10% of the, say it's a 10 story building or having four property on each floor, 40, total there will be a 40 building. I'm giving an example. So these say you can decide to disburse 30% depending on the stage of the construction. But what you know, it is very fluid in the sense it depends on bank to bank. You can if the project is a pre-approved project, and it is from a reputed builder, the bank may even say that I'll initially fund 60%. Right, it's a call by the bank. Right, but on a case to case basis, when the plinth is concerned, that is concerned at the first step of disbursement.
Sure. Right. So thank you. Right. Thank you, Pranay, for sharing your insights on retail assets industry and particularly the key messages. That NPA provisioning is linked to the governance culture of the institution. That was really the crux of your presentation. Sure. I would say so. The explanations of black swan events and even the examples which you shared for internal auditors alertness, were truly phenomenal. For example, a vegetarian Bengali and a 23-year-old, buying a Ferrari, that they were simply out of the world. I personally enjoyed your session a lot.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
It has been an honor. Thank you so much. Stay safe.
Thank you. Bye-bye.